Right now, I want to introduce Andy Kimbrell, whom I've known forever. And he's been involved in this technology, these technology issues, at least as long as I have, except that he's younger than me, so maybe not as long. But he notably started the Jacques Ellul Society some years ago, which was the first kind of formal effort to create a formal institution devoted to the questions that we're talking about today. It was an extremely interesting series of mostly private meetings, but he's also co-organizer of numerous teach-ins on technology starting at least 10 or 15 years ago, together with the Foundation for Deep Ecology and so on. Andy is probably the country's leading activist, or at least one of the leading activists on anti-GMO campaigning, and as a result is the target of many spurious lies from Monsanto and other corporations, but he takes it in great cheer. He's also the founder of the International Center for Technology Assessment, which is the co-sponsor of this organization, as well as the Center for Food Safety. And he's a great writer and a great thinker and a great pianist also. We tried to get him to perform this time with Richard Heinberg, who's a great violinist, who I think will perform tomorrow at some time when we get a break in the action. Maybe Andy can practice between now and tomorrow and they can get to work together. So here's Andy Kimbrell. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Jerry. It's been great working with you on this program. I made numerous suggestions over many weeks and months, none of which really have been taken. But the fact that you have breaks and the fact that we start at 10 every morning is due to me. So. He said, no breaks, we start at 9. So that is the one real influence I think I've had on this program. I want to thank the Open Center as well. They've been doing such great work for so long, and I'm so grateful to them over all these years. And of course, the Foundation of Deep Ecology, which speaks to all of our hearts in this great work. And also, all the people that make this possible. Is Claire Grinsfelder here? She does such an amazing job on all of this, and I just want to thank her personally as well. Thank you, Claire. So I'm supposed to describe the rise and inevitable fall of market capitalism in 20 minutes. Well, somebody has to do it, so I'll take a shot at it. Actually, market capitalism was born out of technology. It was really, if you think of the medieval ages, you think of the mercantile age, really all production was done in the village and most of it was done in the home. Market capitalism really only emerged when the technologies that Richard was talking about of extraction, the dynamos, the machines that allowed for the factory system to be born. That's really when market capitalism started. So sometimes we think of all this technology as the sort of child of capitalism, quite to the reverse. Capitalism is really a child of a techno-utopian view that the factory system could produce sort of a heaven on earth of commodities. So I'm going to be channeling a bunch of folks today, which is, one is Carl Polanyi, one of my very, very favorite writers and thinkers on this. I recommend his book, The Great Transformation, to everyone. If you haven't read it, do. Another is E.F. Schumacher, one of my great heroes, and much of this is sort of patterned after E.F. Schumacher as well. But this is a great quote from Carl Polanyi. The more complicated industrial production became, the more numerous were the elements of industry, the supply of which had to be safeguarded. Three of these, of course, were of outstanding importance: labor, land, and money. Hence, they had to be organized for sale in the markets. In other words, as commodities. This is really, really, really critical, because a commodity is something that is manufactured for sale. So market capitalism is based on the fiction that labor, land, and money were actually commodities. Now, labor is just another word for us, humans. We were clearly not manufactured for sale. Land is just another name for nature, which is also not manufactured for sale. And money is manufactured, but it wasn't meant for sale. It was meant to be an exchange. Adam Smith, specifically in The Wealth of Nations, said, do not start commodifying money, because if you do, you're going to ruin the entire system. So the entire system is based on these fictitious commodities. Now, I'm a red diaper baby brought up here in New York City, and we assumed that the major problem with market capitalism was going to be with labor. So let's start with labor. So, labor. That means you and I are commodities. Sometimes I start this talk by saying, sort of, Alcoholics Anonymous, my name is Andy Kimbrell, and I'm a commodity. Most of us have lived our lives as commodities, because that's what labor is all about. And in the early days of labor, when you were just not even considered a human being, as a commodity, you were disembedded from your humanity. We had child labor, we had the horrors of the seven-day work week. We all know that the satanic mills of England, labor was just, it was a horror show, as we know, and had enormous impacts as well, I think, on our psychology. I have a degree in psychology as well as my law degree. Sometimes law does work in a lot of ways. I am a lawyer, so I have to be a little careful. It's amazing. If you look at the great psychologists of the 20th century, almost none of them talked about living your life as a commodity. What does that do to you? I mean, even when I was an attorney, even before that, when I had small jobs, I was trying to sell my life to an employer, saying, hey, please employ me. What does that mean? But there was an exception. So Freud didn't talk about it, Jung didn't talk about it, but Eric Fromm did. I just want to read this to you just a bit. Eric Fromm says, the average person today is terribly alone and feels alone. He feels himself to be a commodity, by which I mean he feels his value depends on his success, depends on his saleability, depends on approval by others. He feels that it does not depend on the intrinsic value of his personality, not on his powers, his capacity to love, not on his human qualities, except that he can sell them, except that he can be successful. That is what I mean by the marketing orientation. Others are experienced as commodities like oneself. They are not present themselves, but their sellable part. The difference between people is reduced to merely a quantitative difference of being more or less successful, attractive, hence valuable. The process is not different from what happens to commodities on the market. But there was a problem, a major problem, which is that if you really did treat people as commodity, as labor, there was such disruption in society. It was such revolt, it was so disembedded from the realities that were meant to be a human being that it would destroy the entire society. And that's where we saw Marxism, and that's where we saw communism come in. So you had to buffer this fictitious commodity. You had to keep treating it as a commodity, but if you kept it as a straight commodity based on supply and demand, you're going to destroy the entire capitalist system. So what happened? We know what happened in 1917, right? Yeah, also, though, the Department of Labor was formed in the United States. And behind me, you see just the beginning of what all Brother Jones and all those labor people who fought and died by the thousands to be able to change labor laws and to protect labor itself, actually. Okay. Take a look at this. This is all the agencies of the Department of Labor. You see all those things for mine safety, you see the various things for unemployment insurance, you see all the various things that protected labor from being a commodity. We have pension benefits, unemployment benefits, workers' compensation, OSHA, workplace safety. All of this government has been there to buffer this fictitious commodity, labor, from destroying the entire system. So ironically, when the people from the right say, we're against big government, and are big advocates of market capitalism, they're actually attacking the very thing that preserved their system. Big government was required to buffer labor because it's a fictitious commodity that's disembedded from the reality of what it means to be a human being. By the way, the word job originally meant robbery, as in con job. And it was used by the English peasants when somebody was enclosed out of their land and gone into a factory, it was job. And then if they went further, they would call them careering, which is the same word in England as careening. Because they would see them around the streets running, careering around. So robbery and then careering around, sort of senselessly. And E.F. Schumacher, in his beautiful work, Good Work, contrasts that idea, that commodity idea of getting a job and selling your life with the idea of vocation and a profession, a calling, and spending your life in a profession. It's sort of the non-commodity in view of that. And Eric Fromm, in a beautiful book called To Have or To Be, says that the deal, the Machiavellian deal here, the deal here, is if you can convince people that their lives, as this is very much what Richard was talking about, are about having, not being, you can convince them to sell their entire lives away for money as labor, because they will be able to buy a house, they'll be able to buy a car, they'll be able to buy all those fun little electronic gadgets. So to have or to be really describes a lot of the deal that was made psychologically to get people to buy into this disembedded view of themselves as labor. There were some Supreme Court decisions that it shouldn't be a commodity, it has to be protected. By the way, when you look at all these things, it is important to remember these victories were fought again in the blood of so many people. This is all the stuff that was done to protect labor from being a commodity. Ah, but remember land. Land is just another word for nature. Land is also, as Anna Otto was saying, she uses commodity, but it's not manufactured for sale. And if you continue to use nature simply commodity, you despoil your air, you despoil your water, you despoil the very resources that are necessary. For example, tuna in the ocean do not understand supply and demand. They have never read Adam Smith, they have never read von Hayek, they have never read Milton Friedman. So they don't know that there's more demand, so they have to increase their supply. They don't know how to reproduce that way. Right? Topsoil, not very economic. It doesn't understand it. It has to reproduce it by how we want it to reproduce because we need it. No, doesn't do that one. The Ogallala Reservoir takes 1,500 years to replenish itself. Doesn't understand supply and demand. And certainly the non-renewable resources that the rich were talking about, they have no idea about this planet because they're not going to be replenished at all. So we have an entire system that treats something as a commodity that is not a commodity and tries to force it to obey supply and demand and it just won't do it. So that's why we're going to be in peak water. That's why we're going to be running out of non-renewable resources. That's why we're running out of fish and fish. Because we're trying to apply in an autistic fashion the supply and demand commodity thing to nature. Now we'll try here to look at all this government to try and stop that from happening, to try and buffer nature from being a false commodity. And by the way, as an attorney, I work in almost all of these pieces of legislation. Clean Water Act, Clean Air Act, NEPA, Water Quality Act, all the zoning laws. It's all a way to try and keep nature from just being an absolutely free market commodity. All this big government is there to protect us from doing that. We know it's not going to get there. You know, as a kid, as I said, we thought labor was going to be the contradiction that would bring down the market capitalist system. As I became an environmentalist and learned more and more, I believed that it was actually the destruction of nature that was no longer going to be able to support the system. Of course, I think that's still true. Here's all the natural resource agencies. All of these are put in there, again, to try and keep this commodity. Actually exploited fully. But I think I was wrong. I don't think that nature is going to be the final contradiction that brings down capitalism of those three fictitious commodities. So again, I just want to give you this picture. We have this, what Polanyi called this double movement. Wow, market capitalism was creating this amazing wealth of commodities, right? At the same time, it had to protect itself from the complete destruction that had been created by these fictitious commodities, had they been allowed to be treated as straight market commodities. And so over a long period of time, over the last century or more, we developed all of this big government to protect those three. So it's a double movement, getting all these commodities out, and also building enough government, enough regulations to try and save the system from destruction. And one of the big, and Richard added this a little bit, of course, one of the big things is money. Right? If we just allow people to trade in money and trade in debt completely, as we saw in the Great Depression elsewhere, the entire system would collapse. Right? So we have all these various acts to try and protect money. It's the Dodd-Frank. All of this government to say you can't just speculate at will. All of these rules have to be followed, otherwise it'll bring it down. So what's happening? So we see that by treating labor as a commodity, we had it disembedded from all basic human qualities. By treating land as a commodity, we had it disembedded from all natural laws of regeneration. Try to apply supply and demand. And now what we've seen with capital is sort of vampire capitalism. When I was a kid, 72% of the top 50 US companies still owe their position to control and exploitation of natural resources, very much what we were talking about today. By 2013, more than half of the 50 companies were involved in finance, computer-related and financialization, and only 10% of natural resources. As of today, the top 25 hedge fund managers made four times more than all the Fortune 500 CEOs combined. Meanwhile, return on invested capital, which had stabilized around 5% 20, 30 years ago, is now 2% and dropping as investment corporations and managers extract ever more for themselves. So now even capital is disembedded from any production of value. Yes, capital is the enemy of nature, as Joe Cavell's wonderful book says. Yes, that ownership of the natural resources created the problems we just talked about with nature as a false commodity. But take a look at this. Capital is now no more about creating any value, it's about exchanging value. Richard talked about debt. These are the people that are betting on your debt. They're bundling your mortgages, your car loans, and they're betting on whether you're going to pay them or not. They're going to bet on what's happening in Mozambique and in Tanzania, or whether Greece is going to go off the euro, and then they double and triple and quadruple their bets, hedge funds and derivatives. In 1998, we had $5 trillion invested in derivatives. Today, it's close to $600 trillion, right? That is 10 times the gross national product of the world. It's now invested in derivatives in the casino economy. Capital has become completely disembedded from exchange value and even utility value. Now it's created its own financial products. It's metastasized in order to try and gain ever more. Good sound effect, huh? It's metastasized. I mean, 10 times the gross national product of the world in bets. This is a huge bubble. So I think what's going to happen is, well, let's talk to you. These are not Marxists, mind you. This is Forbes magazine. Unless our bottom line, unless our society is a whole reverses course, it is headed for a cataclysm. Because you can't sustain $700 trillion in bets. Because those bets are based on volatility, right? If you're a hedge fund manager, if you're working in derivatives, you want a volatile market. You want prices to go up and down. You want to bet short. You want to bet long. You want to be able to bet back and forth. So not only have $700 trillion in this stuff, it's made to be volatile. That is simply not sustainable. It's completely disembedded from any normal rules of capital. So I believe that we're probably going to have 2008 times 4, times 5, times 10. I believe that Forbes magazine has about right, and other folks there from Eduardo Porter and even Senator Elizabeth Warren saying we are headed for absolute catastrophe. So ironically, when I was a kid, I thought it was labor was going to be the great contradiction, which it still is, and then nature, which it will be. But I had not realized the irony that it was going to be capital that would kill itself. I didn't realize that capital itself was going to be the source of its own destruction. That's poetically interesting. That's a certain irony to it. But it's going to be very traumatic. We're talking about a lot of hard landings here, and we need to face it as this community looks forward and tries to create a new future. Whether it be in the hard landing that Rich is talking about, that we're already seeing with the non-renewable resources, whether it's capital collapses. We know how traumatic 2008 was. Imagine that many times over. We know how many jobs. We know the people that have lost their homes. We know the enormous human suffering that was involved. So this is going to be a hard landing. And with most of these kinds of hard landings, it's going to be very important what the narrative is. If you take the Weimar Republic example, as I call it, right, and the collapse of the economy in Germany in the 30s, they had a narrative, right? Who was at fault? Communists and Jews, right? If we were to have a collapse like this tomorrow, what do you think most people would say the fault was?
You.
Not me, that's not nice. No, big government, right? These idiots don't know their own history, so they're attacking, and by the way, that makes this collapse even more likely because they're attacking the very safeguards that were put up in the last century to try and protect this vampire system from itself. So this system is a zombie paradigm walking. It is still extracting natural resources, as Richard talked about. It's still taking land, as Anurata talked about. It's extracting now all this money, not any value, just moving it up to the top 1% of the hedge fund managers and to those who are moving the money around, right? It's a zombie paradigm walking, but no one knows this story. So when it collapses, we're going to have narratives that are going to be blaming the big government, going to be blaming immigrants, right? Unless we have a counter-narrative. Unless together we come to a counter-narrative. And I don't have a panacea for that. I don't have a panacea answer for you, but I do know that if we are able to somehow communicate that you cannot have an economy that treats people as mere labor here and around the world, you have an economy that's disembedded from the qualities of what it means to be a human being, from our power, from our love. You can't have an economy like that. You cannot have an economy that is disembedded from the laws of nature. Human economy has to be a wholly owned subsidiary of ecology or it will not work. End of story. Ecology is the true economy. And you can only have, we have to re-embed our economy in human values, re-embed our economy in nature's laws, and re-embed our economy in the proper use of money, whether you call it slow money or exchange. Money is useful as an exchange. When it's taken as a commodity, it creates the cataclysm. So it's our job not only to diagnose and speak that narrative, but to begin together to create a truly embedded economy that respects human values, ecological rules, and common sense aspects of money. Thank you.